Hello, everybody. Welcome back to our final day of the Global Composition 2018. Glad to see you here again. Before we dive into our last keynote speaker, there's some practical information for you. You will get a certificate for attending this conference, and you have two options. The first option is to pick it up yourself at the reception, and the second option is to pick it up after our plenary discussion this evening. And I have good news. The press has an interest in our conference here, and Ms. Breitzameter will tell you more about this.
Yes, thank you. I want to share with you, I think, because it's good news and it also sheds an interesting light on the conference and on our topic. We had very, very good press presence at our press conference. We had, for example, the TV of the Hessische Rundfunk here, the Hessenschau, which I don't know whether you're familiar with the German public radio and TV system, but this is a very, very crucial, program which is going on the TV station of the whole state, the whole federal state of Hesse. So I think this is really, really very nice that they brought it, and it's it's basically every household watches that, and this is, I think, really a big success that they are interested in the topic. Then we got coverage from Darmstädter Echo, which is the newspaper of the city of Darmstadt, but also in the region of, the region of Weinheim, Bergstraße, and so on. So it covers quite a region, and it's the newspaper for those who are living here. Then and they have written a very nice article about us. And we also have press coverage from the Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung, which is not only distributed in Frankfurt itself, but it's a nationwide newspaper. And then, of course, we are present in some smaller newspapers, which is, of course, also relevant and nice to us. But what I want to say is you rarely find press and TV, I forgot, Southwest German Radio also brought something about us, although they were not present at the press conference, but they were getting information for us, phoning with me and so on. So, yeah, I think this is pretty, pretty good, and it shows that the topic which we are talking about here and which we are dealing with is a very relevant topic to the overall world, because there's rarely an academic conference which is distributed in that way. So there is really not much going on in that field if it comes to academic conferences. But obviously, these media thought that this is something everybody should know about. And I think, as I said in the beginning, this sheds a very interesting light on our topic, and we should not forget about that. It seems to be really interesting for the overall population, let's say. So it's considered a relevant topic. And I would like to share this with you, because I'm very glad about that, and I'm very glad that we all contributed to that. So thank you for being part of it.
Okay, so we should go on. Sorry?
Are there copies in the hall of the press?
The copies of the
papers.
Who should have done that?
I don't know. Not just the article.
Yeah, but who should have done that?
You have the article or not? You have read it.
Oh, well, you know, I'm sitting down at night time and cutting out the article.
I'm sure they're online, and maybe we can set up a newsletter for all participants and just send it to you after the conference.
Thank you. Yeah, that's a good idea.
Okay, so we will go on with our next keynote speaker. He is what we would call in Germany a real Urgestein, so to say, a real institution of of natural soundscapes. All his recordings are without any equalizers. He depicts the pure nature. He worked at the Natural History Museum at the Bodensee in Germany until his retirement, but this could not stop him from making field trips and recordings in the nature. He released several CDs with bird songs and natural sounds, and I'm sure if there is a certain bird song here in the German woods, he already recorded it and heard it somewhere in his life. I'm very happy to have him here today, Walter Tilgner.
For the first, I would very much like to thank Frau Professor Breitsameter to inviting me here to Dieburg. Her invitation enables me to tell you something about my hobby, my love of the forest and of recording natural soundscapes. Now in retirement, together with nature photography, it has become the mission of my life. And my wife, Heidrun, has always strongly supported me. Yeah. Das ist immer noch dasselbe. Ja.
Jawohl.
In a radio broadcast on Austrian radio in January 2nd, 1986, Professor Dr. Dr. Hannes Meyer, Professor for Forestry at the University of Natural Resources and Life Science in Vienna, Austria, quite accurately described my love in the woods, 1986. You hear him original.
Österreich 1.
Herr Tilgner ist, glaube ich, der beste Waldfotograf in Mitteleuropa. Schon mit seinen Bildern hat er nicht nur das Äußere, das sofort Sichtbare, sondern das ganze Wesen des Waldes erfasst. Er ist von dieser grundsätzlichen Einstellung dem Walde gegenüber, vor allem von der Empfindungsseite her, mit seiner Platte noch viel weiter gegangen. Er hat hier ganz Ausgezeichnetes geleistet.
Encountering the forest and its diverse soundscape throughout the year and season has always been something I have enjoyed immensely. And it helped taking difficult aspects of my life a little easier. These encounters have also shown me that the forest, which seems so peaceful to us, can be quite different for the animals and plants living in it. The cohabitation of many different living creatures in the forest means that the battle for space, light, water, and food is fierce. And this battle becomes fiercer the less space these individual creatures have competing for the same set of resources. The forest has also shown me that all of these very different creatures rely on each other, giving each other help and protection. For example, owls, tits, bees, bats, and dormice, as well as many other animals, use the breeding burrows created by woodpeckers. Another example, only the forest as a whole can withstand the impact of storms. The healthy thriving of an individual, therefore, depends considerably on the well-being of the entire woodland community, a balanced forest climate, and a wonderful soundscape. In 1790, Immanuel Kant wrote in his work, Critique of Judgment, quotation, it has to be nature, or has to be taken to be nature by us. And likewise, it has always been my desire to record the sound characteristics of each forest in the most natural way possible, and with a desire to continue improve my knowledge of the various voices, trying to re-experience this and to pass on the joy to others. You can immediately recognize whether a photograph is blurred or it has a color cast. With sound recordings, this is a bit more difficult. People are all too easily get used to poor recording quality. And in the past, I used parabolic microphones, which are still the standard for ornithological research. This technique enables you to differentiate well between the individual voices and to visualize them in sonograms. But I have never been satisfied by the actual sound, at least not until 1983, when I was able to produce a recording that fully satisfied me. By using digital recordings technology together with a Neumann KU81E dummy head. It was the wonderful reproduction of natural spaces that fascinated me. I was able to listen to these recordings for hours without my ears getting tired. I felt relocated to the actual recording location. And this was a dream come true. Analog technology and parabolic microphones now belong for me to the past. And I am also extremely happy that my recordings of natural soundscapes brought joy to so many people. Some music therapists even used my recordings to great success. Wolfgang Fasser, a graduate music and physiotherapist from Switzerland, wrote his master thesis on natural soundscapes in music therapy. And this is a big incentive for me for to continue my work along these lines. And over the last 34 years, my archive of digital recordings has grown enormously. And I am happy that a part of my recordings will be archived at the phonogram archive of the Austrian Academy of Science in Vienna. It's the oldest phonogram archive. There, my recordings are available for scientific research and for the general public to enjoy. And now, from human beings and birds. As early as in ancient China, long before our era, birdsong symbolized the unity between heaven and humanity. And when there were no radios, TVs, or internet, people kept songbirds at home in cages. They were liked and kept not just for their song, but also to talk to and for entertainment. the family of Mozart in Salzburg and Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart himself in Vienna kept songbirds in their rooms. Records tell us that Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart was especially fond of a starling. He bought for 34 kronen at the bird market in Vienna. The popularity of keeping birds in Vienna was reported around 1500 by Antonius Bonfim, and he was an Hungarian court historian and subject of Matthias Corvinus, King of Hungary in Vienna. A quotation, "In the halls and summer parlors, they kept so many birds that anyone walking through the streets could easily think they were in the middle of a green, cheerful forest." 1500. Another example can read from Philip Ludwig Hermann Röder, a cleric and travel writer. He lived from 1755 to 1831. The Viennese, especially the women, he pronounced it as Frauenzimmer, are particularly fond of songbirds. Beautiful cages hang in all the windows with nightingales, canaries, bullfinches, blackbirds, larks, and other songbirds, and all singing at the top of their voices. No wonder that the thrush nightingale and the nightingale were still captured in large numbers into the 19th century. A bird catcher was a reputable profession and which is echoed in the songs, operas, and verse at the time. The mass ruthless capture of nightingales and thrush nightingales soon led to them becoming very rare in certain areas. Therefore, in 1686, already the capture and keeping of nightingales were forbidden in Brandenburg and in the Grand Duchy of Weimar. A nightingale tax was relieved for keeping nightingales in cages. This amount to some D-Mark, Deutsche Mark, 1850 a year, quite a great sum of money in 1886. Today, that would be equivalent to more than 100 euros. And around 1877, the bird seller Zifsa from Troppau in Moravia alone often sent up to 1,000 pieces of in order to satisfy demand for thrush nightingales in 1894, however, Matthias Rausch, a bird seller in Vienna, complained that the disproportionate snatching away and thinning out had a bad effect on the thrush nightingale song. Matthias Rausch writes about the thrush nightingale in his book, Die gefiederten Sängerfürsten. The thrush nightingale as a singer ranks higher than the common nightingale. This we know by the general known fact that the nightingale increases in value when it copies the song of the thrush nightingale, and the thrush nightingale reduces in value when it assimilates the melody of the nightingale. And this shows the great knowledge and just how familiar bird lovers and dealers were with the song of birds. And bird lovers still argue about which of the two birds sing more gracefully and beautifully, the thrush nightingale or the nightingale. Sorry, das ist... Es geht nicht. Now the nightingale. And now the thrush nightingale. And now my nightingale. And so thrush nightingale. Lucinia, Lucinia. And now, bird song from the past. An example for the loud bird song heard in earlier times by us is our skylark. Today, heard only very rarely in Central Europe, we can only guess how frequently and how impressive and how omnipresent this bird song used to be. Through to the 19th century, larks used to be caught in millions. And this figure refers merely to the Leipzig region. These sumptuous delicacies were packed up and sent as far as Paris for it. How do we know this? For every 60 of larks had been caught, 20 Pfennige had to be paid in taxes to the town of Leipzig. And in Leipzig can report income of about 15,000 Deutsche Mark, which is equivalent to 5 million birds a year. To put up, stop the larks being caught, in 1876, the Saxon King Albert removed the lark from the list of birds that may be hunted, and this put an end to the mass killing of larks for food in Saxony. And now the song of a skylark. The deep sound is a bittern. Thank you. Another example is a Viennese cookery book published in its 21st edition in 1798. It lists 580 different rules for cooking. The many recipes for flans, cakes, animals living in the wild, fish and birds are remarkable. For example, the many cooking instructions for preparing frogs are also an indication as to just how extensive and loud the frog concert must have been. A concert of frogs we could only dream today. Over 40 years ago, I heard a deafening concert of frogs at Neusiedler See, Austria. It could even be heard clearly from the village, which was some distance from the lake. I still dream of falling asleep to the sound of frogs and toads, and unfortunately back then I did not own a tape recorder. And today's frog concerts are much smaller and therefore quieter. Also at Lake Neusiedl and at Lake Constance, according to my own observations. Look. And now a frog concert from the Neusiedler See in the so-called Hölle. Hölle means a place outside the village. 2013 recorded. The photo shows the original recording situation. The microphone. Another example from the Lake Constance, a trig frog chorus, rumbling thunder in a woodland pool near Allensbach, my home, in the evening. I have never heard a tree frog concert chorus at this location since 1990. The little about history from the past. Incredible, soon after it was possible to record and play sounds, shellac records came out featuring birdsong and in particular that of the nightingale. The earliest recording of a birdsong known still to exist is that of the song of a caged white-rumped shama thrush, made on a wax cylinder by Ludwig Koch in Frankfurt am Main, 1889. And it is preserved at the BBC Sound Archive. An impressive recording of a nightingale by Butterding is by Beatrice Harrison. The shellac is from 1927. And in 1722, Christoph Christian Sturm wrote with great feeling about the nightingale. The nightingale is a musician of the first rank amongst the inhabitants of the air. And it is a bird of poor experience whose color form and the whole of its exterior is void of anything attractive or majestic and has nothing in the least distinguishing. The bird might give rise so many useful and edifying reflections. The nightingale is a lesson not to trust to appearance. The reason I have quoted this is because this book by Christoph Christian Sturm was found among Ludwig van Beethoven's estate, well worn and included many personal comments, and the lines, "Nature as a school for the heart," appealed to him particularly. Just how birdsong contributed to Beethoven's work is revealed especially well, for example, in his Sixth Symphony and the statement by Beethoven that has been passed on, "Three birds helped compose it." The birds, cuckoo, quail, and nightingale can be heard clearly in the score. This is the original manuscript score. Thank you. And this is just a very, very small example for the multiplicity of cases where composers have integrated bird songs in their pieces of music. Oh, that is, da is it. Sorry, es ist etwas verschief gelangt. And now, das ist doch. And now, the song of the nightingale. And now, the singing nightingale. I want to show another example of the nightingale. I don't. Is a lake frog concert a nightingale of a nightingale on the Lake Constance? And now also a nightingale concert at the Neusiedler See in 1987. The whole bird concert in the morning with nightingale. Thank you. There are two nightingales. And on the same place, some years later, you hear the difference. And I cannot imagine spring without birdsong, without the drumming of woodpeckers, the melodies of the blackbird and nightingale. But the silent spring already become reality in many parts of the USA a long time ago. And we can only guess just how diverse and rich the down chorus was many years ago in Central Europe. Back then, the air, water, and earth were not so polluted as they are now, and the countryside had not been so built up as it is today. And it would be beautiful if we could have audio files from these days gone alone, days gone by, and not just written descriptions. Here in Central Europe, we are already noticing a forest dieback, dying of forest, as well as a decline in insect and bird populations. The consequences for the future and for bird song too cannot be predicted. And some of my natural soundscape cannot be repeated as the diversity has already reduced. And the rewards we get from caring for living and nurturing our countryside, the forests, are manifold. It's up to us. And for the end, a little composition with real natural sounds. I called it the Fall Frühling, Early Spring. and thank you for listening.
Thank you very much, Walter Tilgner. I think nowadays it's kind of rare to find true passion, and I think you have true passion for what you do, and this is, I admire this very much. So for you now, you have the time now to ask questions or start a discussion. If someone wants to add anything or have a comment, yes?
I hear bad. But
sorry. Say it in German.
Ja? Okay. Ich habe eine Frage wegen der Zeiten, wann Sie aufgenommen haben. Erstmal habe ich mich ganz, ganz herzlich bedankt für die Arbeit und den tollen Vortrag und diese wunderbare Präsentation. Und dann ging es mir um die Zeiten. Sie haben früh am Morgen, spät am Abend aufgenommen.
Das meiste ist very early in the morning for sunset and in the evening and night.
Mm-hmm. Und meine
Frage. Holy night.
Ich war tatsächlich, ja.
I sit in the forest maybe holy night.
A holy night.
Okay.
Also, ich war in einem Hotel in Berlin an der Spree und da war es erstaunlich ruhig. Und die Nachtigallen haben immer gesungen. Immer. Ja. Tag, Nacht, immer, immer. Ist das normal oder ist das?
Das ist ganz normal. The male nightingales, the female nightingale sings not. It is. It sings only the male, and the wife nightingale genies.
Okay.
Yes. Is listen. Ne?
Listen.
And the nightingale is what is the song of the birds, nicht wahr? They want to show how am I a big man, a big male, and have a good revere, he is food, ne? And come to me, and we will have young. This is a and to so vertreiben, Nebenbuhler vertreiben.
The competition, yeah.
And therefore, if the biotope is suitable for the nightingale. It may be that 4, 5, 6. We have seen the picture of the in the Hölle of this. We call it Nightingale Street.
Yeah.
in a small, maybe 500 meters, you can hear 10 to 15 nightingales. Not every year, but sometimes. Ne? And this is a place I visit
every
year. Maybe every year. I can. And the best natural recordings, as a natural recording of bird songs, you can record before sunset.
Mm-hmm.
Sunrise and after sunset.
So I probably just tell, because I don't know if the English guys got it, that it's completely normal in Berlin, even in the city, that they sing all day and all night. I was surprised about this.
Thank you very much.
More questions?
Dankeschön and thank you. It's me. Thank you very much.
Können Sie hier?
Is that deep voice?
Von hier sprechen, dass die Mikrofon nicht so machen.
Ach so.
Thank you very much for a very moving and informative presentation. For some reason, I started to think about the two world wars, and I wonder whether there was any studies or any reports about what effects a war would have on landscape and therefore on the birdsong. Do you have any information about that, or maybe even experience?
I did not understand it.
okay, ich sag's auf Deutsch. Ich musste aus irgendeinem Grund an die Kriege denken, die Weltkriege, und wollte mal wissen, ob da irgendwelche Studien sind, die...
I don't know.
You don't know, okay.
I don't know.
Yeah, because...
Probably the Second World War at an end at 45. And at this time, there exists very poor recorders.
Yes.
I know the Tandberg recorder, maybe 10 years later, we have to curl and and have a recording of 1 minute or so. Ne?
Also, da sind auch keine nichts darüber geschrieben?
Geschrieben sicherlich.
Ah ja, yeah. I was asking about whether something had been written about it.
Aber if you are interested, one can look about in hunting literature. And there is a lot of... wie heißt das noch? Geschrieben.
Reports.
Ne? Maybe one can find a little about this.
Thank you. Dankeschön.
Maybe to respond to Hildegard, there is, for example, not about the population of birds and the sound, but description of the forest in France when the German ambassador went to Compiègne for the peace accommodations or for the speaking about making peace in World War I. And then he knew the forest from beforehand, and I don't know if anyone has a picture or an image of French forests in their heads. Usually French forests used to be very, very large, even at this time still. And then he said, as he traveled by train through the forest, that there was not much left about, or from the actually very big forest. There were huge holes and trees ripped all over the place, and so the actual life place and the habitats were hugely or heavily impacted by this. Also, I was at Verdun, one of the sites of the longest lasting battles in World War I, and there you can still see that vegetation is still affected because it's usually used to grow a long time, and then there was this sudden impact, and you can still see the consequences.
History sometimes is really crazy, because I'm living near Aachen, which is the Belgium-Netherlands border, and there is what they call a Panzersperrlinie. So they put huge blocks of concrete, and they're still there, which is not really, really big. It's about probably 30 meters, but it's really long. And this is now a natural habitat for protected species.
So I guess we have, some time for some questions.
Thank you very much. I enjoyed very much your talk. And I think it is very important what you're doing. From my area in education, I am sad when I see that children today, when you ask them about the sounds of birds, they say that it's tiu tiu. So it's every bird almost is the same. So this knowledge is so valuable to bring to the future. And I wonder if you have done any work in the schools with children.
Well, it is very difficult. But the best argument is you have a was this heißt Amsel? I weiß nicht was auf Amsel.
Blackbird.
Blackbird, yeah, blackbird. You have a blackbird and this is not a blackbird.
Deutsch hier antworten. Ich war in der Schule tätig und als ich meinen Mann kennenlernte, habe ich im Schöpfverlag, wo seine CDs herausgegeben werden, angerufen, dass mich das Waldkonzert damals nur auf einer Kassette sehr interessiert. Dann habe ich die Kassette bekommen, bin in meine Klasse gegangen und oft habe ich Märchen erzählt. Und dann kam ich hin und sagte, heute hört ihr eine Kassette. Und die Kinder waren beschäftigt mit Handarbeit. Jetzt war ganz leise und sie sagten zu mir, bitte nicht, wenn es die Schulglocke läutet, aufhören. Das war also länger als 45 Minuten. Wir wollen die Kassette zu Ende hören, das Waldkonzert von Walter Tilgner. Da habe ich gesagt, okay, wir hören es zu Ende und dann machen wir die Pause und gehen auf den Schulhof. Dann kamen die Eltern und sagten, was ist los? Am Wochenende, wir müssen mit den Kindern in den Wald gehen und die Vögel suchen, die wir gehört haben, und die Eltern möchten mir uns die Vögel zeigen. Es kam eine ganz große Beschäftigung nebenbei in der Klasse mit den Eltern, mit den Kindern, Bilderbücher mit Vögeln, Stofftiere, kleine Stofftiere, Steigtiere kamen hin, und ich machte in einer Ecke vom Klassenzimmer einen Tisch mit Büchern, mit Stoff, mit, also alles, was mit Vögeln zusammenhängt, lag da und wurde von den Kindern benutzt, auch in Freiarbeit nach Montessori, habe ich auch gemacht, Maria Montessori. Es war eine wunderschöne Zeit. Man kann mit den Tönen, mit den Aufnahmen, aber auch mit anderen in die Klasse gehen und es versuchen, und natürlich auch die anderen Lehrer. Ich habe immer eine offene Türe gehabt zum Klassenzimmer, dass die anderen Lehrer auch zu mir kommen konnten. Also das zu Ihrer Frage, Kinder und Wald.
Okay, I will try to get the essence of what you just said. So actually, she was working in schools with pupils, and she was finding out about this Waldkonzert, this record of Walter Tilgner, and she was buying it, the cassette, and then she was playing it during classes. And the children really, really appreciated it and enjoyed it, and they were like, don't stop it, let it play, even after the bell rings for the break in schools. And this adds up so that the pupils really started to have a whole interest in the whole area of birds. They started having these bird plushes, and they want to go to the forest and want to see the birds in real. And they appreciated the sound in a new way, actually. And that was the beginning of something like a whole new project, I would say. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And she said that the parents also wanted to be part of this. Yeah. So that was the.
What's going on?
Yeah. Okay. If there's one question left, I would say we have time for one last question. If not, we can now depart to the workshops or have some break on the toilet or whatsoever. Yeah, Eric.
Actually, this is not a question.
So I'd like to take a moment just to talk to, if I'd like to get up.
Yeah, sure.
Walter, I just want to say on behalf of the World Forum for Acoustic Ecology,
yeah,
in recognition of your lifetime of achievement in nature sound recording, for the great contribution you've made for scientific research and public enjoyment in these sounds, we would like to honor you as an honorary member of the World Forum for Acoustic Ecology.
Thank
I hope you
very
will accept
much.
Our
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. I wrote this note for you. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, so I guess I will close the session right now. That was really like emotional somehow. And like I said, the workshops will start soon, but you have time to go in an appropriate speed to the rooms. And then see you this evening during our plenary session to close this conference then. Thank you.